tears running down their faces for what was happening to their neighbors. Some of them may have been cheering it on. Some of them may have just been gathering out of morbid curiosity the way you do when something terrible is happening. I don't know. I'm not sure any of us can know. But people gathered and watched while their neighbors' houses burned. There was uproar. There was a grand jury. There were 107 indictments that came out of that grand jury for the violence, the destruction, the arson, the murder. Of those 107 indictments, there was one conviction against a white man who took a saber from an African-American soldier who came at the governor's request. <clears throat> 110 years later, we're gathered here to remember. You take a breath. Are you nervous?
I should be.
I'm nervous.
So I wanted to mention that business district that was burned down, which was called 11, is still a business district here in Springfield. I believe at that time predominantly African American and Jewish businesses, and now sits Horace Mann and other businesses. Just to give you a little bit of information. I hope so. I think I'm lit up. You can hear me? Wow. It says red on.
Red means dead battery.
Ah. Can you fix me up?
Well, I think one of my responsibility as a white person in this day and age is to share power.
Okay. So before I even begin to try to answer questions, I would like to give a disclaimer. So I'm very, very black, but I in no way represent the whole constellation of black people in the U.S. who are very diverse and not all think like me. So have we got that? This is Wes McNeese speaking. What is my background?
Oh, I didn't, but that's an excellent question.
Okay. All right. So this is my racial background. I am African American, proudly African American, and that means something particular to me I know folks use the word, but for me, an African American is a person of African ancestry who also is a descendant of US slaves. That's my definition of an African American. And I am proudly African American, as best I know. On my mother's side, as far back as I've been able to trace, there was Robert Jones, and he was born a slave in Richmond, Virginia, and brought to Arkansas. So on my mother's side of the family, we come up out of Arkansas. Robert Jones, by the way, did go on to become a private in the U.S. Colored Troops. He's my great, great, great granddad. On my daddy's side, I don't know as much, but I do know that Mr. Robinson was born a slave in Richmond, Virginia, and brought to Mississippi because of the brick wall that you run in sometimes trying to research your slave ancestry. I don't know as much about him, but my daddy's side of the family, Mississippi, so Arkansas and Mississippi. But I'm proudly African American primarily because I am very proud to be a member of a group of survivors. When I think back on all the stuff that my ancestors went through, and I'm standing here on this stage, I am proudly African American.
Well, you and I didn't compare our stories about our ancestry, but I have a great, great, great grandfather whose last name was also Jones. We may be kidding, but we don't know. And I don't know a whole lot about my history either, partly because the ancestors I can trace came through the southern migration routes rather than the northern ones. Northern ones were often whole communities of people, Germans, Swiss, Norwegians, that moved as whole communities, built churches and schools, and still into the 20th century spoke those European languages. Pella, Iowa still had people speaking German and Dutch in the middle of the 20th century. My European folks came through the southern migration routes through the Carolinas, and at least one of my dad's cousins made jokes about our ancestor having been a horse thief and came through the penal colonies. I don't know if that's true. But they did come through those southern migration routes where communities did not travel together, but men followed the mines and the railroads and whatever women happened to follow the camps. And so as a child, the only part of my cultural history I knew anything about was that I had a great-great-grandmother who was Cherokee. And that would have been about the time of the Trail of Tears. I didn't know anything about the European side, although it's really clear that I'm a white woman, right? Until I was in college and actually went to Europe for the first time and found myself in places that felt familiar even though I had never been. So the lines that I can trace, and they're only the men because the women's histories get lost, trace back to Scotland and Ireland and Wales. I was 20 years old before I learned that my last name, Phillips, was Welsh.
It's Welsh?
Welsh.
Wow.
Eight letters, six continents, it's not Czech, so Welsh can do this.
That's very interesting, especially, so I like the part about the Indian ancestry. I just finished reading a book, it was called The Black Indians. It was just a fantastic book, but it talked about how much intermarriage there was between Native American Indians and African slaves, and how we somewhat blur or forget about that relationship. So there's a lot of kindred spirit that's going on there. I simply wanted to mention that to you. I recommend the book, fantastic reading. So here's a question for you, getting to the race part. What stands out most to you about the race riot in Springfield in 1908? What do you see as being most significant, most notable?
Well, those that were today, we'd have to be talking about 30,000 people would be standing around watching. Those are huge numbers. And there was this resistance, this move to do something about it, the grand jury indictments. And hardly anything came of it. But all that destruction happened, and for all intents and purposes, no one was accountable for it. No one was accountable. People were murdered, and no one was accountable. And this is our history. This is our community. And yeah, I'm new here, but I'm going to claim it as my own. Is that all right? Because it wouldn't matter if I was somewhere else, I would have something like this history elsewhere. The fact that those events inspired the creation of the NAACP is one of the things which it's a hard thing to be proud of, right? It's hard to acknowledge that the violence happened and also something as significant as the NAACP has come out.
So my reaction to it is similar to yours. I'll take two bites at that apple. The first thing that is so poignant to me is that it happened at all. That around that time of U.S. history, the early 1900s, those first 50 years, there were at least 30, maybe 40 such riots. That it happened at all troubles me to no end. And no, I am not from Springfield, I'm a transplant too. But I went to school here years ago, and I've been living here now for 18 years. But I think it's something of an indictment of the mentality of our society that race riots happened back then and continue happen now. The other thing I will have the privilege of talking about a little bit later this week down at Union Square through a poem that I wrote is that I am amazed at how some people can perpetrate horrific, violent acts. And there were many during the riot here and in other riots, how people can do that and then afterwards on the very same ground stand and pose for a photograph. What is going on in that mentality? So, yeah, about the 1908 riot, that stands out.
So what's the biggest racial problem you face today? Because it's now 110 years later, 2018. We'd like to think that we're beyond this, that we've evolved, we've grown, we're wiser, but we have people literally marching through the streets in our country with swastikas and saying awful, awful things and justifying continued violence.
So I could choose any number of things, but let me choose one thing that is a big racial problem for me, and that is a sense of vulnerability. That's a problem for me. And a little bit of something that I call post-traumatic slave syndrome. Wherever I go, whatever I do, in whatever part of my life, I always feel vulnerable to people who may want to harm me, may want to bring me down rather than work with me and or lift me up. And because I am the descendant of slaves, there's a sense of inferiority that rises up in me from time to time that I have to beat back down. Regardless of what I may achieve and what I may accomplish, that always comes in there. And I think it's because of my racial memory and the things that my ancestors went through But I deal with that vulnerability and trying to keep myself pumped up for what I need to do. By the way, I think I would have been something special if I hadn't had that background. I think I could have been a much better man if I didn't have that background. But I am proud to have forgotten. How about that? Okay. So here's something that I noticed about you. It's remarkable that you would even allow such a conversation to take place in your pulpit, and you are white. Okay. So I'm trying to understand, why do you pay attention to this history? And why should other people who are white pay attention to this history?
I think one of the things that I have felt convicted by is when I realize that I don't know my own history. When I get surprised by some element of my history about how people from the places I've been, or the people who look like me, the things that we have done, or what my country has done, or what Christians have done in the name of faith. When I was in Synod School 2 weeks ago, I took a class on the doctrine of discovery. Do you know this phrase? Some of you do. The doctrine of discovery. This is a doctrine that is pre-Reformation, so we can all claim it. But it came out of the Roman Church, and it was a series of papal bulls, which can be summarized this way. When white Christians explore the world, this is the 15th century, right? So just as the Europeans are starting to spread out, anywhere you land that you find is not already occupied by white Christian people, you can claim that for your crown and church, and the people that you find there, you can subjugate or destroy as acts of faith. I'm horrified. And we did it. As people of faith, we did it. So I'm convicted when I discover these new bits of history. And when I come here, I learn some history. This is do y'all know this book? The Ten Ministers book? Written by Roger Chapin. Number 10, I believe it is. No, not number 10, not that far along. Thomas Logan was the pastor here 110 years ago. And in the story about him, I want to share just a couple paragraphs. 1 year after the Union evening services had been inaugurated, the Springfield race riots of 1908 occurred, and these services had to be suspended that summer in obedience to the command of the authorities for people to remain in their homes after dark. Dr. Logan had a personal experience on the first night of the race riots, which forcefully demonstrated to him their violent and lawless character. While he was on his way to attend a meeting at the courthouse, some of the rioters chased a Negro past him, and when he remonstrated with them, one of the rioters struck him violently in the face. Later that night, he met with Governor Dineen and pointed out the growing danger and urged the calling of the militia, and this action was promptly taken by the governor. On the following Sunday, he gave directions from his pulpit as to the public discipline during the riot, urging law-abiding citizens to be deputized and assist in enforcing the law or to stay at home after dark. On the next succeeding Sunday, he preached a vigorous sermon on the riot, pointing out the laxity and corruption of public officials which permitted the lawlessness and mob violence, and admonished law-abiding citizens to remedy the situation. At the time of Dr. Logan's death, Rachel Lindsay remembered his leadership during this period and paid him the following tribute. In the days of the despicable race riots, Reverend Logan's
okay. So last night, I fell asleep in bed watching an old movie from 1941. Gary Cooper was in the lead. It was called Sergeant York. Anybody with me? Old enough? Okay. In the movie, whenever they would greet one another, they would ask, "How you doing?" And somebody would say, "Tolerable." That's how I feel about racism in Springfield in 2018. It's tolerable. It's quiescent. It's covert. Especially in my world, I do not meet a large number of people who are overtly racist. But I know they're there. My spidey sense tells me that they are there. But I think it's undercover. There's still room for it. And I'm not sure what it is, but so you're doing it, and we're having a difficult conversation, and there are groups in this city who are trying to have conversations around race. But I guess, I know we don't have total time, but how do you feel, or why is it so difficult for us to have these conversations around race and white supremacy and all of those kinds of things? Why is that so difficult for America?
Well, I also cannot speak for all white people.
Okay.
But you mentioned earlier how you have to fight down a sense of inferiority. And I think as a white person, one of my temptations is to feel like I have what I have because I deserve it.
Oh.
Because I earned it, because I worked hard for it, and if someone has less than me, then they should just work as hard as I do. And then I learn more about history, and I learn about policy, and I learn about redlining, and I learn about the fact that the GI Bill was available to white veterans who came back from World War II, but was not available to black veterans. Did you all know this? I learned that history and realized that I have benefited in ways that I wasn't even aware of. That I have advantages that people are not suspicious of me the way they may automatically be suspicious of you. And that those biases are in me.
Yeah.
Like, I've grown up in it, and it's the air I breathe. And so it's one of my challenges is to fight down a sense of entitlement and racial superiority.
Wow. Do you think it's systemic?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
And that's a whole other conversation. And anyone who's interested in learning about systemic racism, I've got some dates for you in October. But I think it's a difficult conversation for us as a nation because we feel guilt and we feel anxiety and fear and we feel embarrassment when we don't know our history. And we're complicit in ways that we don't even recognize. And when we start learning it, it's hard to deal with all of those emotions. And one of the challenges that I try to face in my own life is to recognize that my feelings about racism and white superiority are not as important as your lived experience. That me feeling embarrassed about white supremacy is not as important as you actually being black.
Gotcha. I accept. You know, Susan and I agree that we would close this conversation, and that's what we're about to do, by trying to speak to the scriptures and how the scriptures speak to this reality. She's the pastor, so I'm going to go first and let her wrap it up. So I read from Ephesians, and that's a Pauline letter. Thought to be. But I read from Ephesians 4. I want you to go back and do reading on your own But if you go through the first three chapters, you'll find that Paul is trying to teach us about membership in the body of Christ. That's what those first three chapters are devoted to. And then in the fourth chapter, he shifts and he begins to talk about what are the membership rules if you're going to be a part of the body of Christ. And the first two-thirds of that fourth chapter, he talks about things that you should not do. In other words, I remember some of the words. Don't be like children. Don't fall victim to scheming doctrines. Be not like your old self, but like your new self. And then this, the 25th verse is what I read to you. That's where it comes in, and that's why it says, so then. And that's when Paul begins to tell us about what you should do. And one of the things that jumps out at me is that he says, be angry, but don't sin. That's where I'm going to put my hat down, because I remember the title of today's sermon, Anger to Love. And here's what I need to tell you. I am angry. It didn't take a psychiatrist to help me get that out. I am angry because of history. I am angry because of present day. I am angry because of everything that I have to go through, dealing with my family. I am angry about my job and the respect that I don't get. I am angry that I have to worry about driving home today to my house, where I am, and who will be in the car next to me. I am angry. But the scripture says that if I am to be an imitator of God, that I need to take on his best characteristic, which is love. And despite all the anger, and despite all that I've gone through, I have to love. Now that ain't easy. It's not easy for me, and it's not easy for you. But that's his main characteristic. So I will admit to you that I'm angry, but I have decided to follow God. I have decided to follow his principles. So I suppress that anger. I bring it under. And I try to live my life and teach my family every day to live their life, to love people. There was a time in my life which I was very militant. I'm talking about physically militant, actively militant. It didn't last long. I found out real quick that I was outnumbered and outgunned, and so I changed my tack. But for most of my life, I've been a person of love. And God says that if I am to imitate him, which is what I want to do, that I must love you. And oh, by the way, he says that you must love me too.
Is repeated. Did you notice that? As though the psalmist encourages us to speak truth and live in love.